falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. That's why they persecute, but you are going to stand. Matthew chapter 10, verse 22. Matthew chapter 10, verse 22. And you shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, because you are holding on to the name of the Lord and the doctrine of the Lord and the righteousness that come through the name of the Lord. It says the name of the Lord is like a mighty tower, and the righteous runneth into it and is safe. Because you are holding on to that name and the righteousness of the Lord, that's why they persecute. But it says that you will not be afraid of that. Ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved. When you endure in that righteousness, remain in that righteousness, abide in that righteousness, and you don't allow the persecution, the jesting, the joking, and the insult and the assault to move you, and say righteousness is the way to heaven, holiness is the way to heaven, purity of heart and life is the way to heaven, and that is the way to stand. And you stand in it, that is when you are going to endure, and you endure to the very end. 2 Timothy chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 10. 2 Timothy chapter 3, we're looking at it from verse 10. It says in verse 10, but thou hast fully known my doctrine, my manner of life, my purpose, my faith, my long-suffering, my charity, my patience, my persecutions, my affliction, which came unto me at Antioch and at Iconium and at Lystra. What persecutions I endured, but out of them all, tell me the rest, the Lord delivered me. The Lord will deliver you. You know, when persecution comes, the Lord is right there, and his rod and his staff, they comfort me. And the Lord will not leave you alone in that persecution in Jesus' name. It will increase your faith. It will increase the grace of God in your life. It will give you stamina. It will give you strength. And you'll be able to stand. As the persecutors increase and persecution increase, then the Lord will increase his power, protection, preservation in your life in Jesus' name. And then we're told in verse 12, ye and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But evil men and sedition shall wax worse and worse. Don't let that disturb you. As evil men are waxing worse and worse, the Lord will be greater and stronger in your life. And your faith and your dependence upon the Lord will be stronger and greater in Jesus' name. Evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. You see what the Lord is saying. He says, don't allow persecution to stop you. Don't allow persecution to derail you. Don't allow persecution to stop you halfway. You continue to the very end in spite of all that persecution. In fact, the Lord is saying that when that persecution comes, you're going to rejoice. Look at John chapter 16, verse 33. John chapter 16, verse 33. These things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation. He told us, in the world ye shall have tribulation. That's talking about the temptation, about the trial, about the persecution, about all the troubles that will come. In the world ye shall have tribulation. And you know, sometimes the people you think will never persecute you, they are the people that will persecute. Because if somebody is not born again, it's going to persecute those who are born again. And if somebody does not have the Spirit of God, it's going to persecute those who have the Spirit of God. If somebody does not have a stand, uncompromising stand, righteousness, is going to persecute those who are having a stand, a real uncompromising stand. It doesn't matter, they might love you yesterday and smile at you yesterday and fellowship with you yesterday. It doesn't matter if they don't have any stand, uncompromising stand, if they don't have principle. When you stand for principle, even though they were rejoicing with you yesterday, today, when you are standing for something that they don't want to stand for, they're going to persecute you. But that will not move you in Jesus' name. That's why Jesus said, in the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And because you overcame, you are going to overcome as well. In fact, it says we are appointed unto it. If we are appointed unto it, we are not going to allow anything to bother us or to derail us. We're looking at Romans chapter 8, reading from verse 35. Romans chapter 8, verse 35. It says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? I'm going to direct it at you now. Are you ready? I said, are you ready? Who shall separate you from the love of Christ? Anybody? Shall tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, burial, or sword? As it is written, for your sake, for thy sake, we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, you are more than a conqueror through him that loved you. I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, neither height, nor death, nor any other creature shall be able to separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus your Lord. The Lord will preserve you in Jesus' name. The persecution may come in many ways. You know, it comes sometimes through hatred and bitter rejection. Sometimes it is slander and false accusation. Sometimes the persecution is scourging and beating, or mocking, or insult, or assault. Sometimes reproaches and laws. Sometimes it's dishonor and evil report. They tell some big lies against you, something unimaginable, that even when you are a sinner, there's no way you could have done that, even as a sinner. Not to talk of now you're a believer, you are saved and sanctified, real child of God. And then they said, we're going to spread bad rumor, terrible rumor against his life. And then it goes from person to person, and then as rumor is going around, it's increasing. And then it comes back to you and they say, hey, they said you did this, they said me. And then the devil wants to say, since they say you are a sinner, go and sin now. Since they say you are a backslider, if you are suffering for what you've not done, and everybody is saying, look at him, he's a witch, look at him, he's a sinner, look at him, he's a thief, look at him, he's this and that. Slander, terrible, terrible things they say. Don't allow that to move you. Keep on following the Lord, and one of these days, the Lord will vindicate you in Jesus' name. Sometimes it's betrayal by false brethren. The people who appear to be friends and brothers and sisters, and they are hovering around you as if they love you, are smiling every time they see, and yet in the back, they're conspiring against you, wanting to bring you down, and wanting to destroy you, and wanting to throw a dagger at your heart spiritually. You know, betrayal will be there by those people that are backsliders and not standing, and they'll be thinking they are standing, but you take your stand. Sometimes it's public ridicule, isolation, or excommunication. Sometimes it's suffering, even martyrdom. But our Lord Jesus Christ has warned us, as he warned the disciples, to expect that there will be persecution. The world will not love believers. The world will not appreciate believers. What to expect? The persecution will come from those who hated and killed our Lord Jesus Christ. Paul had faithfully taught the believers in Thessalonica and everywhere too, that for verily he said, when we were with you, we told you before that ye should suffer tribulation, persecution, even as it came to pass, and ye know. The Thessalonians proved the reality of their conversion and the genuineness of their faith by remaining steadfast and committed during persecution. You too, your worst time. Look at Galatians. I'm looking at Galatians now. We're looking at chapter 4, verse 29. Galatians chapter 4, verse 29. Galatians chapter 4. We're reading from verse 29, so that when these things happen, you will know that, you know, it's happening that way because of who they are and because of who you are. Galatians chapter 4, verse 29. But as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even so it is now. The carnal will persecute the spiritual. The sinner will persecute the saint. The backslider will persecute the believer. It's always been like that. The unrighteous will persecute the righteous. It's always like that. The one that doesn't believe the totality of the Bible will persecute the person that is believing the Bible. The one that is not holding any doctrine, just a wishy-washy churchgoer, doesn't hold any doctrine, and doesn't know where he stands, doesn't know the left from the right. He'll persecute the people that are holding firmly unto the word of God. As it was then, so it is now. And when it happens like that, just say, Lord, forgive them that are just carnal. Lord, forgive them that are just sinful. Lord, forgive them that are just backsliders. And because I'm standing a thing, they're going to make me like them by the persecution, but they will not succeed. I said they will not succeed. We'll keep on standing on the truth, this eternal truth, earnestly contending for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints until the final day in Jesus' name. We'll come to point number three now. Paternal feeling, pastoral feeling, parental feeling for tempted, persecuted sons. I'm coming back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, and we're reading there from verse 5. Paul the apostle had been talking to these believers and had been assuring them. He said, I love you. I even wanted to come to you myself, but Satan has hindered my personal visitation unto you. Because of that, I'm sending Timothy unto you, and Timothy will do what I would have done. Look at verse 5 now. For this cause, when I could no longer forbear, you know, the devil had been whispering in the ears of those Thessalonians, Paul the apostle, he doesn't love you. He came over here, preached a rousing message, a wonderful message, and you all just gave your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now you are suffering persecution. He doesn't even remember you, and he's, you know, jumped to other places, and he's gone to other places, and he doesn't care whether you live or you die. He doesn't care whether you're standing or you're falling. He doesn't care whether you're happy or you are sad. He doesn't care whether you're making progress or going back. That's a lie that the people were telling the Thessalonians. They said, where is Paul now? Where is Paul now? He's nowhere to be found. He's gone to other places. He's in Athens. He's in Corinth. He's over here. He's over here. And he will never come back here to you. And he doesn't love, he doesn't have your heart. That's why he told them, look at chapter 1 again. Let me remind you. Look at chapter 1. He said, we give thanks to God always in verse 2 for you all, making mention of you in our prayers. Don't allow anybody to tell you that I, Paul, I'm not thinking about you because I've not come to you. I wanted to come to you. I wanted to do it myself. Even though I could not come, I've been praying for you, making mention of you in my prayers. Look at verse 3, remembering without ceasing your work of faith and your labor of love and your patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father. He told them that he's been remembering them every time. He said, I don't wake up any day without praying for you, without thinking about you. And then come to chapter 2 now. In chapter 2 he said, in verse 17, for we brethren be taken from you for a short time in the presence, not in heart. He said, don't allow what they are telling you. Out of mind is out of sight. Does he remember you? He's too busy to remember you. Don't allow that. You know, that's the lie somebody will tell you sometimes. You know, the pastor is not concerned about this section, about that section, and then you get discouraged. But that's not true. He says, we're taken away from you in presence, but not in heart. Endeavor the more abundantly to see your face with great desire. He was encouraging them that he'll never forget them. That's why he told them in verse 18, wherefore we would have come unto you, even I, Paul, once and again, but Satan hindered us. Then he said in verse 19, for what is our hope or joy or even crown of rejoicing? Are not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ that is coming? For ye are our glory and joy. He said, well, you're not important to Paul. He has so many converts in all the other places. Thessalonica, you think that Paul is thinking about you? He said, don't mind those people. He was reminding them that all the lies the enemies were telling them, those lies were not true. And thank God, all the lies the enemies are telling you, the lies are not true. You know that God loves you. And the Father is thinking about you. Jesus Christ is praying for you, interceding for you, for all your needs. And the Lord Jesus Christ will meet your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Give me a good amen. Amen. And of course, I'm thinking about you as your pastor, as your father in the Lord. And every good thing that you need, the Lord will supply in Jesus' name. And he's going to perfect everything concerning you. That you see my face or don't see my face, that doesn't matter. That doesn't mean it's not just because I come to your district or come to your state or come to your region. Whether I'm there or not, you are in my mind, and the Lord will do everything he ought to do in your life in Jesus' name. Yeah. That's why he said in verse 5, for this cause, when I could no longer forbear, I wanted to come and I could not come. Therefore, I sent to know your faith, lest by some means the tempter, by all those lies, have tempted you, and our labor be in vain. The labor of the people of God concerning you will not be in vain. Let's look at what these tempters, what they do. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. And I'm reading there from verse 2. 2 Corinthians 11, verse 2. For I am jealous over you with godly jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. Paul the Apostle said, that's my concern, that's my heart. I want to present you as a pure virgin, a holy virgin, a sanctified virgin, an undefiled virgin unto the Lord Jesus Christ, your husband and your bridegroom. For I fear lest by any means of the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your minds shall be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. Paul the Apostle said, I'm always concerned that you will not lose the simplicity of the gospel, the sincerity of the gospel, the security in the gospel, and the totality of the gospel, so that the enemy will not seduce you, so that the enemy will not entice you to go into anything false. How do they do that? Look at verse 11. So look at verse 13. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. You know what the devil does? He sends the false apostles, and they come with false testimonies, and they say, well, look at the problem you have. Have you been able to see your coordinator? No. Have you been able to see your group coordinator? No. How about the state overseer? No. How about your general superintendent? No. Well, look at what is happening over here. Just around the corner here, there's another fellowship there, and that man is a great man of God. In fact, we even call him apostle, and he can do this and do this for you. And he says they are false apostles and deceitful workers, transforming themselves to be the apostle of Christ. And then sometimes they'll bring, you know, such the scripture of deeper life out and say, see, we're even using the same material, and we have all the time for you. And if they don't have time for you to be able to, we are here. In fact, we're using the same material, and we're preaching the same message as well. It says they are deceitful workers. They transform themselves to be the apostles of light. They will not catch you. They will not deceive you in Jesus' name. In verse 14, it says, and no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great sin if his ministers, they are ministers of Satan, but they also transform themselves as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. But Paul the Apostle, again, he wanted to emphasize that he was concerned about the believers, because the lies they were telling all those people is that, you know, the pastor is not concerned about you. All he's concerned about is doctrine. All he's concerned about is evangelism. All he's concerned about is missionary work, going from here to there. He is not concerned about you. That's why he said in verse 28, look at verse 28, he said, but those things that are without, then he said, that which comes upon me daily, the care of all the churches. He says, I'm thinking about all the churches, the church in Corinth, and the church of Galatians, and the church in Thessalonica. Then he says, who is weak, and I'm not weak. He said, when people are weak, or they're weakened by the circumstances upon themselves, it touches me, it reaches my heart, and I'm weak as well. Who is offended, and I burn not. And so you understand what he was saying. He said they were in his heart, and you are in the heart of the leaders as well, in Jesus' name. You are precious to God, you are precious to the church, and you are precious to us as well. And I pray that you will not lose the value we place on you, in Jesus' name. In Galatians chapter 4, verse 11, Galatians chapter 4, verse 11, I am afraid of you, lest I have bestowed upon you labor in vain. And that's like a mother talking to the child, because the mother had gone through the labor pain to deliver that child. And then just because the mother went to the market or the mother traveled out to, you know, the village and to come back a few days after, or the mother went overseas because of maybe some important assignment, and then a woman in the neighborhood will come to that child and say, where is mommy? Well, mommy is not at home, and that's what I'm telling you. You know, get this biscuit and get this sweet and get this. And then he's trying to tell that child, you know, that I love you more than your mommy. Hey, understand, biscuit is not his. It's not of so much value, and the things they're giving you, that temporary, they're not of so much value that you will say that, you know, that woman loves you more than your mother. That's the mother that had the labor pains. That's the mother that, you know, cared for you when your baby changed all the diapers and took care of you when you were crying. That's the mother that took care of when you were sick. And just one day woman that came to give biscuit or sweet, that doesn't make that woman greater than your mother. That's what Paul the apostle was saying. He said, I'm afraid of you, lest I bestow labor upon you in vain. Brethren, I beseech you, be as I am, for I am as ye am. Ye have not injured me at all. Ye know how through the infirmity of the flesh I preach the gospel unto you at the first. He said, when I was sick, I didn't say I was sick, I kept on preaching. And when I was weak, I didn't say I was weak, I kept on preaching. When they stoned me and they left me for dead, I got up, I kept on preaching. And when some things happened to me that some in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, blow me over and over, I never stopped preaching. And I did that because I love you. And some people are coming to you now to say, Paul doesn't love you, he's not caring. He said, don't listen to them. Through the infirmity of the flesh, I preach the gospel unto you and the false. And my temptation, my own trial, which was in my flesh, ye despised not, nor rejected, but you received me as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus. He said, where then is the blessedness you speak of? Because when I was doing that, and you got saved, you got sanctified, you were healed, you were delivered, you were blessed, and then God gave you a wife, God gave you a husband, God gave you children, God did a lot for you through my ministry. He said, you were happy. Then he said, where is the blessedness now that you speak of? That if it had been possible, ye would have plucked out your own eyes and would have given them to me. I might therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth. You know, Paul the apostle became concerned. He said, Galatians, what's happening to you? Who are the people deceiving you to say that your pastor, your leader, the apostle, is no more interested in you? He said, they zealously affect you, but not well. Yea, they would exclude you that ye might affect them. They want to cut you off from the very root and from the foundation of what you have got. And I pray that will not happen to you. That's why he said, but it's a good thing to be seriously affected, always a good thing. And then he says, not only when I am present with you, my little children, I'm concerned over you, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you. I desire to be present with you now and to change my voice, for I stand in doubt of you. I pray we'll not stand in doubt of you. You'll keep on standing firmly until the very end in Jesus' name. And that's the feeling Paul the apostle had for these Thessalonian believers. I'm concerned about you, I'm concerned about you. He repeatedly told them. And that's the same thing we're telling the church, that our leaders are concerned over the members. Our leaders, coordinators, group coordinators, state overseers, pastors, and local government everywhere, we're concerned over you. You are going to stand. And we'll all get to heaven together in Jesus' name. Are coming to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, we're looking at verse 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Look unto Jesus. Any trial, any tribulation, any challenge, any sickness, anything that is oppressing your life. It says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. And don't you forget what the Lord has taught us all these years in verse 14, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. That's what they want to get away from you. They want to uproot you from your foundation. They want to dissuade you, get you away from your conviction. They want to say, hey, those people, all the preachers, holiness, all the preachers, you know, purity and sanctification. How about healing? We're sick, they're talking about holiness. How about getting married? We don't have any wife, they're talking about holiness. How about getting husband? How about all these years we have married and there's no child yet? I want to see them all, the holiness, holiness. How, what are we going to eat, holiness, when there's no child? They try to discourage you. And they say, you know, prosperity, you don't have your own house, you don't have this, you don't have that, no education, no progress. They're talking about holiness. Don't mind them. Well, they are the people you will not mind. I said they are the people you will not mind. And I want to tell you, all those people that try to discourage you and dissuade you and uproot you from your foundation, I say, don't mind them. Say, I will not mind them. You will stand in the truth. And everything that you need, the Lord will supply in Jesus' name. Whether I see you face to face, physically or not, it doesn't matter. I'm praying for you and all the needs in your life, the Lord will supply in Jesus' name. We're looking at Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. But my God shall supply all your need. I said, my God shall supply all your need. Whether you are in Corinth, you are in Athens, you are in Thessalonica, wherever you are, and even though we have not come to see you, I'm thinking about you, I'm praying for you. And you know, God hears prayer at a distance. You know, somebody can be in Lagos and pray for somebody else, and somebody over there in Port Harcourt or in Benin City or in Kaduna, or in Jos or Kebbi or anywhere we are, as I pray here, God will answer the prayer. Yeah. You know, I remember that, you know, we're having a program in Sokoto, and you know, Sokoto is so far away up north. And then, you know, I was after the meeting that day. In fact, that day, I just went to Sokoto because, you know, the people were telling them, Pastor Kumu, he will never come, that this place is too small for him to come. And I wanted to just assure the people that I'm for everyone. And I just traveled there just to say, hello, how are you there? And then they decided that we will still have an evening meeting there. And I told them, I was just giving them just a little thing that I'll still come back. And the promise is still there. And then that night we were praying in Sokoto. And as I was praying, there was somebody in a Delta State all the way down south. And that fellow, you know, one eye at me, it was a child of 16 years of age. And that child, a security man at the gate of the school, used the whip accidentally and knocked up the eye, and the eye was totally blind. They took that child to many hospitals, and there was nothing they could do. The eye was gone. And then in Sokoto, I said, now we're going to pray. And this brother in Sokoto State there in the city, he phoned the young man in a Delta, and he said, we're praying now. Put on your phone, put it in your ear. And as I said, in Jesus' name, in Sokoto, then in Delta, that eye got opened. That's why I'm telling you that distance does not matter. The distance between you and I will not stop the prayer. Look at Psalm 138. I'm reading there from verse 8. Psalm 138. We're looking at verse 8. In Psalm 138, over there in verse 8, the Lord will perfect everything which concerneth you. His mercy, O Lord, will endure forever. He will not forsake you because of the work of his own hand. Rise up and let us talk to the Lord. The Lord remembers you. Don't allow any discouragement. Don't allow anybody to tell you that, you know, God doesn't remember, Jesus doesn't remember, the leaders don't remember, the pastor doesn't remember. You're in our heart. We'll remember you. The Lord remembers you. Everything concerning you, the Lord will perfect. And the Lord is going to supply your need. Just tell the Lord, what's bothering you in your heart, the persecution, the pain, the difficulty, the challenge that you are having. What's the problem? What are you thinking of going back? What are you thinking of backsliding? What are you thinking of separating yourself from the church, not going to the house fellowship, and not going to the local church, not going to the district church, not going to the zone anymore, and then you're avoiding everybody. They don't love me. They don't love me. Of course, we love you. How could Satan tell you that? Of course, we love you. We're thinking about you. We're praying for you. You are in our heart every time. And if we're not able to come, we'll send a Timothy there. We'll send a Silas there. We'll send a Titus there. We'll send an Epaphroditus there. We'll send somebody there. Epaphras will be there. And whatever they say, that's what we're saying. What I should have said is what your leaders are saying. The prayers you have prayed is what your cleaners are praying. And everything the world shall counsel you the way they are counseling you. And the Lord, through their counseling, I'll counsel my journey heart and hand with them. The Lord will perfect everything concerning you. Don't worry about what the devil may say. Don't worry about what the devil may do. You will overcome. To those who are impure, is a power. To those who are weak, to those who are powerless, supplier to those who are in need. His promises are yours. Accept, believe, receive, and it's yours in Jesus' name. I said it's yours in Jesus' name. You'll never lack. You'll not suffer hunger. Your weakness, the Lord will strengthen you. The power of the Lord will hold you up in Jesus' name. Your enemies will not rejoice over you. Those who want you dead will regret. You remain alive and outlive them in Jesus' name. The power of the Lord will sustain you. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you today. We bless your name because we know you're all things to all your people. And I pray for everyone, your saving grace will come to every life in Jesus' name. And for those who are leaving their sins behind, they're taking you, Jesus, as their Lord and Savior. I pray all their sins you forgive in Jesus' name. And the joy of salvation, the victory of salvation, the power that sustains those who are saved, let it come to those people as they are holding on to your saving grace right now in Jesus' name. Any sickness, any infirmity, any weakness, Lord, I speak your word to that sickness and I command that sick person be healed in Jesus' name. All the oppression, all the attack, all the things the devil is throwing at the people of God, I break every yoke. I destroy the works of the devil. Set your people free in Jesus' name. Total deliverance, total freedom, total liberty. Give unto your people in Jesus' name. Come out of your depression and come out of that evil pain upon your life in Jesus' name. Deliverance is yours. Dominion is yours. Victory is yours. You are more than a conqueror in Jesus' name. Whatever need in your life, in your profession, whatever need in your life, in your family, whatever need in your life, anywhere you are, I pray that right now this God of heaven, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, will supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Your tears are wiped away. Your sorrow is taken away. All the needs in your life are supplied. God has given you a definite miracle you'll never forget. You go back home rejoicing. Your joy, your victory, your salvation, your holiness, your purity, nobody will ever take away. You go from strength to strength and power to power. And on the final day when the Lord shall come, you'll be among the saints that go marching. Lord, confirm it in every life. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Let's pray together. Our Father, we thank you.
Christ, the love of God and the hope of Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow us all the day of our life, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. Praise the Lord, the service over. Please let do all what we can do to be here by the on the eve of New Year by 10. Let off every by 9:30. Let everyone of us be here. And then please invite as many people as possible. God will help us in Jesus' name. Amen.